standing on the banks of the river, looking out over life's troubled sea, when I saw an old ship that was sailing. Is that the old ship of Zion I see? Its hull was bent and bent from the storms of life I could see. Waves were rough, but that old ship was steady. Is that the the stern of the ship was the captain? I could hear as he called out, it will never pass this way again.
As I step on board, I'll be leaving. Oh, with Jesus the captain sailing
out on the old ship of Zion,
sailing
out on the old ship of Zion.
It's not going to work. I was hoping not to have to wear these, but I can't see. So I'm Lee Frazier. I'm Mary Ellen's daughter, and Joan probably referred to me mostly as Leanne, which is acceptable too. It's going to be difficult to find words to do a proper eulogy for Joan. As all of us know, what a special, loving, talented, and courageous person she was. My goal is to share with you some memories that I have of Joan, and you all probably do too, to ease the pain of the loss that we're feeling today. Joan Ann Duncan Winters was born March 25, 1943. She was the second oldest of five children in the family. Joan was well loved and respected by all who knew her. She is preceded in death by her parents, Fred Duncan and Avalee Duncan Adkins, her stepfather, Muncie Adkins. Also preceding her in death is her four-day-old son, David, who passed away in 1968. Her sisters, Jean Jamison, Pat Dickinson, and Mary Ellen Carneal. Joan is survived by her husband, Art Winters, her beloved son, Harvey, and his wife, Lou Ann, and the light of her life, her grandson, Corey. She is also survived by her brother and his wife, Fred and Pat Duncan, and her brother-in-law, Rocky Carneal. Also surviving is her first husband, Glenn Howell. Joan leaves behind many nieces and nephews who were very special to her, and her lifetime friend, Brenta Gibson. Joan grew up in Galax, Virginia. She graduated from Galax High School in 1962. While there, she was a member of the Beta Club, French Club, FHA, Glee Club, Choral Society, and Key Club. She was a Key Club sweetheart, homecoming queen, and captain of the cheerleading squad for the Maroon Tide. She was voted most popular in her senior class and was also named Miss Grayson County in 1960. While attending Radford University, she met Glenn Howell, and they were married in 1964. They owned and operated several businesses, including a restaurant where Joan was the head chef. She worked as a medical transcriptionist and retired from Carilion Health System after 23 years of service. Living her childhood in Galax was a wonderful time for Joan. Her parents and siblings were so close, they were almost always together. The Duncans seemed blessed with musical talent. Her father was the choir director at their church, and he instilled in them a love for music and singing hymns. At every family gathering, the day could not go without singing. The seven of them were like their own choir. Everyone was singing, and Dito would play the guitar, and Joan would be on the piano. Music was so important. They were very close, spending every holiday, birthday, and any other special event together as a family. Loving sports, the seven of them were also like their own athletic team. They enjoyed playing sports together and had a special fondness for baseball and basketball. Family gatherings were special events for all of us. These were times where we would get together and talk, sing, play games, and eat. All of the Duncan women were excellent cooks. Joan in particular was most famous for her strawberry pretzel salad, deviled eggs, potato salad, and well, just anything she brought would be delicious. She was a natural in the kitchen and could make a complete gourmet dinner out of the simplest ingredients. Not only would the food be delicious, but her table would be impeccably decorated. Growing up, we were all blessed with this large Duncan family. There were the five children, and between them, 11 grandchildren, and then 15 great-grandchildren, plus spouses. The grandchildren, Ellen, Harvey, Emily, John, Lee, Alan, Michael, Duncan, Chris, Jared, and Keith. Great-grandchildren, Whitney, Sterling, Michael, Duncan, Whitney, Sterling, Corey, Anna, Julie, Grayson, John, Abby, Hayden, Jack, Lucas, Kyle, Cage, Smith, and Archer. And there was also a great-grandchild, Brindley. As you can see, we have a huge family. Some of my fondest memories are of being in Galax with my cousins, often spread out on those 1970s plastic folding chairs. That's where we would sleep, on lawn chairs. We celebrated many meals with Mom's green beans, homemade rolls, and Swedish meatballs. Holiday events were crowded, yet magical. By the way, when Harvey was cleaning out Joan's house, he found a roll of that plastic cording that you use to fix those plastic lawn chairs, so if anyone has it, has one and needs it, see Harvey after the service. Throughout her life, Joan found great joy singing in church and several local choral groups. She had a beautiful voice and was also accomplished on the piano. Such a talented vocalist, she performed the Lord's Prayer at three of her niece's weddings. She performed in many other events, including singing with Harvey at his church. She was also quite talented at the craft table, making wreaths, flower arrangements, and table decorations. Joan and her sisters and their mother would make so many holiday wreaths, they would hold craft shows at their houses and welcome friends, co-workers, and neighbors to purchase items. Joan had natural artistic abilities, including calligraphy and making custom cards. I sat with her for hours at our dining room table, trying to learn calligraphy from her, never being as accomplished or talented as she was. For any wedding, baby shower, or any other event, we could always count on Joan to decorate the table, and it always looked like something out of a Southern Living magazine. As a child, I was fortunate to have a strong connection with Joan. In 1968, she had a son named David who passed away after just 4 days, and then I was born in 1969. Joan told me many times that I looked just like him as an infant. I know how hard it was for her, yet she only showed me love. She would come over to our house just to hold me, sing to me, and rock me when I was a baby. I have so many fond memories of Joan. Although she didn't have any daughters, she had Luann, Ellen, Emily, and me. For those of us fortunate enough to live in Roanoke near Mary Ellen, Jean, Joan, and Freddie, we spent a great deal of time with them over the years. When Pat moved up from Mount Airy, North Carolina, the Duncan siblings were inseparable. The five of them and their spouses, even as adults, were so close. They were a package deal, celebrating birthdays and other events always together. Freddie's Pat has been more like a sister to them, and we are so grateful for her as she looks after us all. The siblings would attend sporting events for each other's children and grandchildren. There were family dinners, group gatherings at Christmas, Kentucky Derby parties, and so many other fun times. Also, having Mom, Mom, and Pops down from Galax allowed for a lot more family events. Shopping at Hieronymus, Steger Creek, and Kirkland's, to name a few, was a favorite pastime for the sisters. I must admit, I enjoyed some shopping with them myself. In fact, these pants I have on, I was with Joan, my mom, and my Aunt Pat at JJ Fashions when we bought these, and all of us know how much Joan loved a black pair of pants. Joan was always the bright light at any event. She was incredibly funny. She would say and do the funniest things. Often she was clumsy, or just weird things would happen to her. She would try to tell us about it, but she would laugh at herself at the same time we were laughing. She would try to talk, and she would get so tickled that she would be laughing and the words wouldn't even come out of her mouth. But then Freddie and Mom and Pat and Jean, everybody would start laughing, and none of us really even knew what the story was. It was all because Joan was just so funny. Harvey and Joan used to like to watch basketball and football games together. They weren't always in the same room. Often it was just over the telephone. Harvey said that they would talk through the commercials until the commentators returned. Now, anyone who's ever watched a sporting event on TV knows that after the commercials, they usually play highlights or replay, I don't know what you call it, like scenes from the sporting event. Harvey said that during the replays, Joan would get just as excited as if it were live. And she would yell and cheer at the players. She'd say, "Look at him go! Did you see that basket he just made?" And then she'd say, "Run, run, run!" talking to the player holding the ball. Or she would yell, "Get him! Don't let him score!" And Harvey would calmly say, "Mom, those are replays. We've already watched that live." We can all smile at the memories of how Joan was just so innocently funny. Throughout her life, when difficult times came her way, she always maintained a positive outlook and trusted in the Lord. She allowed her faith to carry her through. Joan must have been one of God's favorite children because she survived so many challenges, both medical and other hard times. We know she is up in heaven, reunited with her parents, Fred and Avalee, and her stepfather, Muncie, her sisters, Jean, Pat, and Mary Ellen. I cannot help but wonder if there's a Steinmart in heaven. I know Jean, Pat, Mary Ellen, and Joan, and Mom are there, grabbing all the sale items they can. Because you know, up in heaven, each of them has a decorative bowl on their coffee table that they must shop for new fancy balls and other trinkets and for an everyday stylish look, and they cannot resist that Christmas decorations are already out even in October. Joan has been special to all of us. She was generous, compassionate, beautiful, caring, and talented. She touched our lives and helped us become who we are today. With her latest illness, Joan was lucky to have Harvey, Luann, Corey, Pat, and Freddie by her side to help her through. Her family and friends visited and checked on her by phone to give her love and support. On October 6th, she was surrounded by love with Harvey, Luann, Freddie, Pat, and Ellen. She is in heaven today, looking down on this service, and I hope she can finally see, feel, and believe all of the love and admiration that we have for her. Joan, we will miss you so very much.
My name is Ken, and I'm married to one of the nieces, Emily, and I want to share with you today a poem that some of you have probably heard before or you may not have heard. It's a poem that was written by Linda Ellis. It's entitled The Dash. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted it first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all the time that they spent alive, or that Joan spent alive on earth. And now only us who are here and who loved her know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, or the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about it this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that still can be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real and always try to understand the way other people feel. And be less quick to anger and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read, your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash? You know, it's no doubt today, Joan touched a lot of folks in her life. I know she always made me laugh. I couldn't get over her infectious laugh. And Joan spent her dash well. And you are a testament to that.
Land I'm longing for. Someday on thee I'll stand, where my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land. I'm kind of homesick for a country where I've never been before. No sad goodbyes will there be spoken, for time won't matter anymore. Beulah
On behalf of the family, thank you for being a part of this afternoon's celebration of life service. We have gathered together this afternoon to give comfort and support to the family, to remind Harvey and his wife, Luann, and their son, Corey, that you're not alone during your time of grief and bereavement and loss, to share in the loss of her husband, Arthur, to share in the loss with Glenn and her brother Fred and his wife Patricia, to communicate to Rocky and the rest of these nieces and nephews and friends and neighbors that you're not alone during your time of need. Death is a physical loss, it is a social loss, it is an emotional loss. And so we grieve with those who grieve. The Bible teaches us that Jesus wept outside the tomb of his friend Lazarus. But on that day, Jesus declared, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though they die, they shall live again." And so we gather together to give comfort and support to these family members today and the coming days. We gather together to confirm our Christian faith beliefs. We may come from a variety of faith backgrounds and traditions, but Joan was of the Christian faith. There was a time in her life that she received the grace of Christ. She embraced that scripture text, "For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have and experience that everlasting life." And so today, in the midst of our grief, in the midst of our sorrows, in the midst of our tears, there is the Christian hope. A poem that was written and shared at Joan's father's funeral there at Mount Vale Methodist Church in Galax, Virginia. Church and family and music and scripture were so important to their family. The pilot beckoned, and Joan answered his call. She saw the shore ahead. The lights of home were burning bright for the saint so in need of rest. The father said, "Come, welcome, my child, enter in. Thy work is done. You have fought a good fight. You have kept the faith. Now your race has been run." Joan anchored deep in the cleft of the rock, though fierce winds sometimes would blow. She never feared because she trusted the one whom the winds and waves he controlled. Her ship sailed in right on time, not early, nor was it late. The pilot, you see, is keeping time. And when he calls, one cannot wait. Our dear friend, mother, sister, neighbor, and friend has made it home. Joan will never know pain again. Her worries are over. She's resting within the gates of the beautiful land. Joan is watching for us to join her there. Without the loss of one, we too must anchor deep and stay on board to reach our heavenly home. Joan entered life on that March the 25th, 1943. And she entered her port of safety, that Beulah land, on October the 6th, 2002. And 22. She lived her life to its fullest. She lived her life in relationship with her God. She lived her life in relationship with her family, her friends. She lived life in relationship with her family, whom she loved. She was your cheerleader. She was your inspiration. She is the one that celebrated when you achieve success. Joan was of the Christian faith, beginning her journey there in Galax, Virginia, and then when she moved to the Roanoke Valley, she was a part of Oakland Baptist Church, and she was also a part of the First Presbyterian Church. Joan loved to sing and to teach music. Singing was her spiritual gift, along with the acts of love and joy and peace and kindness and goodness and gentleness. The Bible teaches us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And certainly she accomplished that as she made a joyful noise in the life in which she lived. She was a dedicated choir member. And then when her church asked her to teach the children the music, of the Christian faith and life. She volunteered. Joan's faith and support and love from her family and friends allowed her to overcome many of the challenges of life. And today, because of her faith and trust in the Lord, God has defeated the greatest challenge, death itself. Miley Cyrus sung a song many years ago that's still popular today entitled "The Climb." I can almost see it, that dream I'm dreaming. But there's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. Every step I take, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaking. But I'm going to keep trying. Gonna keep my head held high. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. Ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's the climb. It's the climb. All of us are on the journey of life, and there's times that we face that mountain, those obstacles, those challenges in life. And God has provided his strength, his grace, his love in order for us to achieve our goals. God has also provided the gift of family and friends to nurture us, to support us in this journey, in the climb of life. We have already shared together the early accomplishments of Joan's life. Growing up in Galax, Virginia, as a country girl, in a family that loved her, in a family that supported one another, she excelled in high school with all the variety of clubs and activities, the glee club, the chorale, cheerleading, captain of the cheerleading, key club, sweetheart, and the homecoming queen. And today she is our queen. Today we not only celebrate her dash, her life accomplishments, but more than that, we celebrate the faith, the strength that she lived. It's not how Joan died, but it is how she lived. Not take life or relationships for granted. Learning to love God with all of your heart, with all of your strength, with all of your voice. Learning how to love others as you love yourself. I would encourage this family to continue your family traditions, to hold on to those precious memories, realizing that the Lord is with you during this valley, during this climb of loss. Joan taught her family how to be in right relationships with others. Her life gave us the example to have faith in the Lord and live out your faith daily, even when those challenges of life arise. Life is filled with blessings, and celebrate those blessings and share it with others. But there's times that life is filled with challenges, discouragement, and disappointment. The God who is with us on the mountaintop is the same God that is with us in the valleys of life. She demonstrated the importance of demonstrating faith and demonstrating hope and staying positive in life and using one's gifts, one's talents, each and every day for the glory of God and for the glory of others. Song music was such an important aspect of Joan's life. And one of those hymns that reminds us of the grace of God and the love of God that has sustained Christians for decades now is that song, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace goes through the journey of life. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. There's a time in all of our lives that we are like this person. We are living life. We're surrounded by the grace of God, by the forgiveness of God, by the love of God, but oftentimes we cannot see it. We cannot experience it. But there was a time in Joan's life that she experienced that grace of God, that love of God, that forgiveness of God. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Joan had a faith, a trust, a belief in God. But she also had a hope, a faith, a belief in you today. That you would carry on your life. You would carry on the climb of life. That third stanza of Amazing Grace reminds us in the journey of life, there are the blessings of God. But also in the journey of life, there comes those challenges. Though many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. This grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The faith that Joan had in life led her in this journey, led her to the climb, led her through those toils, through those snares, through those challenges of life. It was grace that brought her to Christ, and it was grace that brought her to him. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Today we grieve and we mourn because death is a loss. We weep with those who weep. But the Bible teaches us that we, in the Christian faith, we weep with hope. We weep and mourn with the confidence that those who have died in Christ will experience the great resurrection. Well done, good and faithful servant of the Lord. You have lived your life well with a dash. Now there's going to be a special video of Joan and Harvey singing.
The sweet land.
That's a special blessing, Harvey, being able to sing with your mom. Hold on to those memories. There are a variety of scripture texts that we draw comfort during a time like this. Psalm 23 reminds us that the Lord, He is the shepherd that desires to walk with us in this life and desires to walk with us for all of eternity. David declared, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. My shepherd leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through that valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. Thou hast prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou hast anointed my head with oil, my cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The second scripture text that brings so much comfort to Christians around the world each and every day is the Lord's Prayer. And so at this time, we're going to hear the song, the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
On behalf of the family, thank you for being a part of this afternoon's celebration of life service. Following our prayer time and the last song, The Old Rugged Cross, Mr. Simpson has some direction to give to us as we have a fellowship time following the service. May we pray together. Our Father, we thank you so much for the gift of life and the promise of everlasting life. We thank you for the life of Joan, Duncan Winter. Father, she entered life and she has made a difference. Father, today we gather together to give comfort to the family, to confirm our faith beliefs, that to be absent from this body is to be in the presence of the Lord for all of eternity. But more than that, we gather together to celebrate a life well lived. As you have walked with Joan throughout her life, you continue to be that wonderful shepherd that walks with us. Father, she has climbed her mountain. She has reached the presence of the Lord. In Psalm 100, the Bible teaches us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Father, throughout her life, Joan has made a joyful sound, a joyful noise for you and for others. And today, we sing her praises. Father, as you have walked with her throughout her journey, you continue to be that shepherd that walked with us. We call upon your presence today to give us peace and comfort and the hope of everlasting life. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
table set, and she would want people to enjoy their time together, share the stories.